Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
Good to see all of you. Simon Peter, James, and John, the sons of Zebedee, these men were the salt of the earth kind of saints. Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary and her sister Martha, these saintly women supported Jesus and his disciples with their pocketbooks, with their encouraging words, and through their presence. Francis of Assisi and Teresa of Avila gave their all in following Jesus, their wealth, their days and nights, their thoughts, their prayers. Look around you, my friends, and you will see saints in the making, for all of us have been called to focus our lives on the teachings of Jesus and to live lives giving praise to our Savior. As we gather for worship today, we remember the saints in ages past and thank God for calling us to be saints in the world of 2021. Using the words printed in the bulletin, let us share it in the prayer of invocation. On this observance of All Saints' Day, we give you thanks, O God, for those who have gone before us, who lived in harmony with your precepts, and who shared their lives and faith with us. May those blessings which they have passed on to us be the blessings we pass on to those who will come after us. In Jesus' name, amen. I will invite us to unite our hearts in a time of prayer. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, for all the saints who ever worshiped you, whether among the trees or in beautiful cathedrals, weathered wooden churches, or crumbling cement meeting houses, where your name was lifted up and adored. We give you thanks, O God, for hands lifted in praise, manicured hands and hands stained with grease or soil, strong hands and those gnarled with age, holy hands used as wave offerings across the land. We thank you, God, for hard-working saints, whether hard-hatted or steel-booted, head-ragged or aproned, blue-collared or three-piece suited. They left their mark on the earth for you, for us, and for our children to come. Thank you, O God, for the tremendous sacrifices made by those who have gone before us. Bless the memories of your saints, O God. May we learn how to walk wisely from their examples of faith and dedication, worship and love. We especially thank you for those who were a part of our fellowship here at St. John's, whose examples of service and love, dedication and compassion have helped to make us who we are today as followers of the Christ. Today we lift up prayers for Lanny and Linda, and for Carl, who had knee surgery, for the victims of that explosion, and for all of those who stand in need of your presence. We pray, O God, that your Spirit would draw to all of those near to all of those who especially need you in this hour. We also offer up prayers for the President of these United States and for the leaders of nations all around the world. May your Spirit bless them and guide them in the ways of peace with justice. And now, O God, in the silence of these moments, each of us comes to you with our own thoughts and prayers and petitions. In addition, O Lord, today we thank you for Cade and Kevin and Lisa and their presence with us. And now hear us as we offer to you the words of the prayer which Jesus himself taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
When we all see Jesus. Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want.
He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Okay, the first reading comes from John 14, verses 1 through 3. This is from the New International Version. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. The second reading comes from 2 Corinthians verses 5, 1, 2, and 4, and this comes from the Revised Standard Version of the Bible. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Here indeed we groan and long to put on our heavenly dwelling. For while we are still in this tent, we sigh with anxiety, not that we would be unclothed, but that we be further clothed, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. God grant us an understanding of his holy word. Amen.
Amen.
Thousands fall about you. guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they'll bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone.
In 2012, Patricia and I realized that I needed to go back to work. I was fortunate that I was able to participate in a training session to become an intentional interim pastor, and I received a call to serve St. John United Church of Christ in Defiance, Ohio. Patricia and I found an apartment in the adjacent community of Napoleon and settled in. Toward the end of that year, we found a home to rent just south of the city of Defiance. We remained in this home rental until my call at St. John ended about 3 years later. While we had anticipated moving back to the home from our to the house that we had in Alexandria, Kentucky, and were in the midst of doing so, when another opportunity to do another intentional interim arose, and we took it. It all happened rather fast, and so we rented an apartment in what turned out to be a questionable part of town. Soon we moved from there into one half of a duplex. When the noise from the neighbors got too loud, we moved again. This time we rented an old farmhouse just east of the town of Enon, where the church was located. We were at this church a total of 3 years. When our ministry in Enon ended, we received a call to serve St. John's here in Mansfield. Now, before we moved to Mansfield, two members here at St. John's, Cecile Hendrickson and Jim Saltzgiver, helped us look for housing in this area, and we especially appreciated their assistance because of the previous mistakes that we had made. As it turned out, an ad Patricia found online said, "No pets." But somehow she missed that. The landlord, when he and his wife learned that I was a church pastor, overlooked the fact that we had not one, but two cats. And we have lived on Middle Belleville Road, just 7 or 8 minutes from the church building, the entire time we've been in Mansfield, which is this month will be exactly 3 years. So let's see. In these 9 years, we have lived in two places in Defiance, three places in Enon, and thankfully only one here in Mansfield. That totals 6 places in 9 years. Anybody close to that record? Recognizing that it was time for me to retire from ministry a second time, in part because of high medical costs, which fortunately have been resolved, last spring, Patricia and I purchased a double-wide mobile home in Asheville, Ohio, which is just south of Columbus and Grove City. We're hoping to be in one place for a while. But who knows? What we do know is that we've already downsized, and when we finally move, we'll be downsizing a great deal more. Yay! Oh, did I say that? I share this image of moving from one house to another because all three of the authors of our scripture text for today use the image of a house. The psalmist speaks about living in the Lord's house. Jesus talks about the Father's house. And the Apostle Paul writes about living in a permanent dwelling rather than a temporary presence. Hey, Patricia and I can really, really appreciate Paul's insight. And whether it's called the Lord's or the Father's house, sure sounds good to us. Now, when you move around a lot, you realize that it takes a lot of organization. It means sorting out what's worthwhile, what's worth saving, and you come to know what you really need, what's truly important. You come to know what truly is to be treasured. And as I said just a few moments ago, we're still in the midst of this process, which really is never ending. Now, my friends, life is like that. It takes a lot of organization. It means sorting out what is worthwhile in living each and every day. And you come to know what you really need, what's truly important. And of course, these kinds of things are especially important to new parents. You come to know what's truly to be treasured. Well, let me continue by telling you about Erica, a woman who was a member of the church we served in Cincinnati. She and her husband, Harold, had been married 20-some-odd years when she passed away. Although she never had any children of her own, Erica was one of three sisters, all close in age. Her other two sisters had children of their own. They all lived in the same area of Cincinnati, known as Oakley, and all attended the same church, the United Church of Christ in Oakley. Now, Erica had a hobby. She was a photographer. Whenever there was a birth or a baptism in the family, she took pictures. Whenever there was a wedding or an anniversary, she took pictures. Whenever the family got together for the holidays, Erica was always there with her camera. What Erica treasured in life was family and friends. Well, Erica died unexpectedly one fall, and at the first family get-together following her funeral, that holiday was Thanksgiving. Of course, everyone in the family encouraged Harold to attend. Now, in the past, somebody in each of the families fixed something for the Thanksgiving feast. But Harold was not a cook. And no one in the family expected him to prepare anything for this Thanksgiving meal. But Harold, he wanted to bring something to share. So after the holiday meal, he walked out to his car and he brought in two armfuls of photograph albums filled with photographs which his wife Erica had taken over the years. And over the next couple of hours, these albums were passed around to oohs and ahs and plenty of remarks like, oh, do you remember that? And by sharing those photographs his wife had taken over the years, everyone in that family, that Thanksgiving, felt blessed. Now, what Erica left behind wasn't just a collection of photographs. It was her collection of memories. What she left behind was her love for all of her family members and the opportunity for them to recount special moments in their lives. This remembrance prompts a question for all of us who gather here in this worship space today. What will you and I leave behind? Well, let me tell you another story about another person. Sometimes clergy are called on to lead a funeral for a person they had never met. I didn't know Ed. While Ed's family still lived in a crowded city, he had moved soon after retirement to a quiet area outside of town. When I met his family to talk about Ed, here were some of the things that they told me. He loved his country and served honorably in the European theater during World War II. His service included several months as a POW, a prisoner of war, near the end of the conflict. On returning to the United States, he began working in his working life as a meat cutter. From there, he went on to become a salesman. He enjoyed golf and gardening. Family members assured me that I would have liked him because he was a big-hearted, honest, friendly man. He had a zest for life, and he lived by high standards. His family was important to him. His children, of which there were half a dozen, mentioned that he could hardly pick up any one of his grandchildren without tears filling his eyes. They also made it clear to me that Ed was not perfect. They told me that some of the roads he traveled were filled with potholes, and occasionally he came upon detours. What Ed had to do in the course of his days was to make mid-course corrections. Everyone in the family could recall apologies that he had made to them, sincere apologies. In life, a wise person in the course of their journey begins to put all of the patterns that they see, put those patterns together and make sense out of the jumble of experiences that we call life. And that's what Ed was able to do. In spite of the fact that Ed, a husband and father and grandfather, was not perfect, he loved as best he was able, and that love was returned. Like my previous remembrance of Erica, this one of Ed again prompts a question for all of us here today. What will you and I leave behind? Let me close today by inviting our Savior Jesus to weigh in on our question. While there are some in the Christian community who emphasize the beginning of that relationship, that is the moment a person proclaims Jesus as their Lord and Savior, there appears to be more to our salvation than simply that. At least that's what Jesus suggests. In the 25th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus tells us a parable in which all of the people who have ever lived are gathered on a plain before God. And in that moment, God divides them into two groups, the sheep and the goats. The goats are sent to what we call hell, while the sheep receive a heavenly reward. And here's the difference, according to Jesus. The sheep are those people who provided food for the hungry, water for the thirsty. The sheep saw the strangers and the foreigners among them, and went out of their way to welcome them and make them feel at home. Jesus goes on to say that the sheep saw the needy and provided them with clothing. And when the sheep learned that someone was sick or in prison, they went out of their way to visit them. And then Jesus adds this remark, "Whenever you did these things for the least among others, it was like you did it to me." Hearing these things, the goats are upset. They cannot ever remember seeing Jesus among the hungry or the thirsty or the needy. They cannot remember ever seeing Jesus among the foreigners or the strangers. They cannot remember ever seeing Jesus among the sick or the imprisoned. And Jesus suggests that they never opened their eyes. All they cared about was themselves. That's sad, isn't it? If we were to ask Jesus to comment on our question this morning, what am I leaving behind as my legacy? I'm thinking that he might say, when you treated others with as much love as you could and showed them your love, when you went out of your way to care for others, even those who were strangers to you, when you shared a kind word or an encouraging response, when you shared some of your abundance with those who were less fortunate than you, you were leaving behind a sacred treasure. Why, it's almost as if you saw my face in someone else. My friends, for me, in the end, it is wherever we have walked while clasping the hand of God, while showing and sharing gifts of love that we ourselves have already received from Christ. That is our true legacy to all of those that we have loved in this life. And that, my friends, is a wonderful thing to leave behind. Amen. On this day, we observe the Christian holiday, I guess, which we call All Saints Day. And I'd like to invite those who lost a loved one during this past year to come forward and join me here at the table. Come on up, Dave. And Karen. And Jim, and Janice and Charlotte, are your loved one? Do you have loved ones listed here? No, it's okay. I will read the names, and you can share the name of your loved one at the right time. I'll share the names of those who passed away that we want to remember today. And we're going to see the entire list. We begin with Dennis Theaker and Daniel Burgess Sr. and Joanne Montan. Sorry. Oh, come on now. There we go. And Dave, if you would light a candle in Joanne's memory. And just put that candle right on the table. Terry Stone, Alan Stoner, B. Henry. Horst Baim, Daniel Burgess Jr., Marilyn Minnick, Dion Porter, William Benzing, Mildred Babel, Janet Ziegler, Clarence Ward, Ruth Deal, and Roger Beach. And your loved one? Jack Keller. And now, friends, if you would join me, and let us offer together the congregational prayer printed in today's bulletin. It's a little difficult, isn't it? Oh, we have the words right up there. Let us pray. Almighty God, who has knit together your people in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of Jesus Christ, grant us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those unspeakable joys which you have prepared for those who love you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I was there to hear your morning cry. I'll be there when you are old. I rejoice the day you were baptized to see your life unfold. I was there when you were but a child, with a faith to suit you well. I'll be there in case you wander off and find where demons dwell. When you found the wonder of the work, I was there to cheer you. Praise the living God, to whom you now belong. Should you find someone to share your time, and you join your hearts as one, I'll be there to make your
Friends, as we come to this time of communion in our service of worship, we do so remembering that we gather in Christ's name. It was around the table shortly before his crucifixion that Jesus gathered with his disciples and shared with them his love for each and every one of them, in spite of the fact that one would betray him and another would deny him, and they would all just up and disappear. He still loved them. It didn't matter at that moment what they did. What was important was that he loved them, and they in turn would later love him and become saints. As they gathered about that table, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you eat it, remember me." Likewise, after the supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the remission of sins. As often as you drink it, remember me." And so it is that we gather today in remembrance of Jesus. Now, friends, here at St. John's United Church of Christ, we practice what we call open communion. That means that anyone who wishes to commune is welcome at this table. You don't have to be a member of this church or any particular church. All we ask is that you be seeking after God in your heart. You do not need to be perfect, for God is in the process of perfecting each and every one of us. Nor do you need to be sinless, for we believe that God forgives all our sin. With these words of invitation, I invite us now to this time of communion. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, for this time of communion, and pray that we might always sense the presence of your Son Jesus in our lives, and may we be led by him through those paths that lead us to the life eternal. In his name we ask it. Amen.
Shall we gather at the river, where bright angel feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God? Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. On the bosom of the river, where the Savior King we own, we shall meet in sorrow never, glory of the throne. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Ere we reach the shining river, lay we every burden down. Grace our spirits will deliver and provide a robe and crown. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Soon we'll reach the shining river, soon our pilgrimage will cease, soon our happy hearts will quiver with the melody of peace. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God.
Friends, the Apostle Paul reminds us that when everything is said and done, three things will remain: faith, hope, and love. Of these three, however, the greatest is love. May the love of God be with you to bless you now and forevermore. Amen.
Go out now in peace with Spirit anew, for surely God's grace is living in you. Reach out with God's love through joy or pain. The shepherd will keep you till we see you again. Go out now in peace with Spirit anew, for surely God's grace is living in you. Reach out with